Love is Blind season 5 should be called None of This is Love. None of y'all should be dating anyone. Like, this is a mess. This show is, it's a mess. What is the point? There's only 3 couples who even go make it to the honeymoon. And I don't want any of them to be together. They're all terrible. Not terrible people, but none of them should be dating each other. And maybe not even at all. You're definitely not ready to get married. But I want to focus on this couple. And also, I want to, if you haven't watched the show, good. You will not get your time back. I'm going to I'm going to use this couple as like a really good lesson on how to avoid a terrible relationship / marriage by doing what she did. Take notes from her, okay? Okay, so let's get started with her. Taylor, I don't know. She's like a lot of women and she's Southern, okay? Now, being Southern myself, I understand. I mean, I know Texas is different, but I understand that as a Southerner, a white Southern woman, there's an enormous amount of pressure to cater to the male ego, to basically run the whole family, like run the show, but pretend like you're not, and, you know, hide everything you do behind some like strong man who is actually usually a total coward. But I feel hope now because of her, because she really wanted to get married. She acted a little too desperate, if you ask me. But, you know, I'm a cynic, y'all. If you follow my page, that's probably why, is because I'm a realist, okay? But I also do believe in hope. So I don't think that she will lose hope, but I hope she learned a very good lesson in being realistic and understanding the delusional thinking that goes behind really wanting to get married. And if you're not careful, you will end up with a man who has emotional intelligence, seemingly. Now, I don't think he's a bad guy because I don't think anyone is good or bad. But this guy is a firefighter. And I know that we just worship firefighters, but firefighters are like, you know, one level down from cop, okay? They may not be obsessed with the power stuff, but they love to be a hero. I'm not saying all firefighters are bad. I dated a firefighter. He was a nothing like this. But in my experience, firefighters, men who are into extreme sports, adrenaline sports, climbing, a lot of them have unresolved childhood trauma that they haven't really dealt with. Like, they may think they've dealt with it, but they think going to the gym and running a lot and putting themselves in terrifying, dangerous situations that they can then toughen their way out of, right? And be the hero of their own life and then the hero of other people's lives, that somehow that is going to make them good men or good people, because that's what I was. I was a female version of this guy on some level, minus all the like privilege and misogynistic, blah, 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 whatever, you know. And so this guy, you know, when he's talking about like being a firefighter, and she's like, well, isn't that like scary? Sounds like it's scary, like, you know, because he's talking about how he didn't sleep well. He's like, I mean, it's scary because you like go into a burning building, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, it's only a little scary, but it's an adrenaline rush, y'all. If you know my content by now, as a former cool girl and adrenaline junkie, please beware of people like me, or the former me, until I spent a long time facing all the things that made me want to do dangerous jobs and like do things that I would almost die in all the time. I'm not saying, by the way, I don't know these people, okay? Y'all can be, people are always like, yeah, blah, blah, blah. Obviously. And I am projecting a lot. Literally everyone who watches TV is always projecting their own story, the same way people project onto me all the time. Right? That's what people do. But as somebody who did dangerous jobs, saw people die at my job, like, you know, was constantly terrified, but also like unbelievably calm in these terrifying jobs, and then was an adrenaline seeker, like loved to live in constant fight or flight. There's, not always, but oftentimes behind that, something that reminds you of your family system, something that reminds you of your childhood. To be scared, fretless all the time is normal. And that's why most normal people don't do those jobs. Now, we need people to do those jobs. Some people are not traumatized. Some people are just normal people and they just want to do it. But I'm telling you, be careful with firefighters, search and rescuers, like any of these, like, you know, hero jobs. Just saying, be careful, okay? Because honestly, I doubt he has any friends. He says it's the camaraderie with your crew. That's one of the things that I love that too. I loved being in dangerous jobs so that I could be afraid of dying all the time, and that bonded me with my coworkers and my friends. Just saying. And we know that he doesn't have close friends because when he was telling this story about his childhood, which sounds like it was very difficult, he said before crying into his American flag, I mean, seriously, y'all, this guy has like major like MAGA vibes. I'm sorry, but this is a good old boy. I'm sorry. Nobody loves the American flag this much without being hating women on some level. Anyway, this is a red flag. When a man is like, I never opened up to anyone like you before, never told anybody this before, that should not make you feel special. That should tell you to run, because that means this man is not talking to a therapist, not talking to his friends, even though he spends countless hours with his bros in the fire department, sitting around waiting for a fire. They go through hell and high water together. They save each other's lives, but he's never told him about this, about his childhood. That is not good. And we will see why when they're on their like honeymoon thing. Do not feel special when men say that you're the person that makes them open up. They have not done the work, y'all. Men who will not talk to anyone else but you about their problem, you are going to be this man's therapist, because he hasn't gone to therapy and he won't go to therapy until you literally threaten divorce. Also, I mean, the sugar butt, sugar, it's too much for me, y'all. As much as we love seeing a man be vulnerable and talk about things like his past, that, I believe, is why she fell for him. That was the one time he opened up and let her see some of his past and some of his feelings. He cried. And, you know, she's like, oh, cool, he's emotionally intelligent and he's going to be at least vulnerable with me. Uh-uh. And like most women, she's just doing too much, y'all. Where she went wrong is not only missing these red flags, which is understandable. I've missed red flags like this before. But she also sounded too desperate, because there was a time when he was like, I'm not talking to the other girl. She was like, well, why don't you just propose already? And then he didn't say anything. She's like, just kidding. Don't be doing this, y'all. You didn't even know the man. She didn't know this man. So when they first meet, they're all like, yay, yay, yay. This dude would not talk. If you go back and watch it, which I don't suggest you do, please don't waste your time. He just shuts her up by kissing her a lot. And I've noticed a lot of these couples, they clearly, especially the men, when they don't want to talk, things get vulnerable, they're just like, give me a kiss. Shut up. They shut you up by kissing you. But he was so awkward and weird, didn't have anything to say. I mean, right away in their first conversation, outside of what, not having a literal wall between them, which is such a perfect metaphor, because this man probably has a wall around his heart like a lot of adrenaline junkies do. And right away she's like, I'm gonna run out of things to say. I don't like that. And guess what? That's what the 4 days of like honeymoon, that's all it was. Start off the honeymoon thing with their sugar butt, sugar blah, blah. Boom, immediately. That first meeting was kind of awkward. Feel like I was afraid maybe he didn't like me. And he's all like, you overthink too much. She's like, yeah, I think I overthink. He's like, yeah, do you think you overthink? This is going to be his running deflection. You overthink. This is how she gaslights her. I'm overthinking. When she knew something was off. Stop gaslighting yourselves. Yes, we can project all kinds of stuff. When I was in my first healthy relationship, I'd made up a lot of lies too. But something consistently felt off. And she would not ignore it. Good for her. She's even like, well, you're just such a dude. Because he just doesn't have anything to say. And doesn't overthink like her. Like, must be nice. It's not because he's a dude. Men can be emotionally intelligent if they do the work. Then she's all like, I'm starting to have doubts because I want a divorce like my parents and I'm having doubts. And then she's again, and he's an American flag short. Let's talk. And he's like, what do you want to talk about? Like, I don't know. Like, she's already exhausted. I've told y'all one of the red flags and dating app is if this man is having you carry the conversation, bad, bad. You're already doing all the emotional labor. That is the tone you're setting, and it's not going to get better. It's only going to get worse. And again, she's like, maybe we should put a wall up so you can open up again. This is her go-to line. She says it all the time, but it's true. And again, he's like, you overthink too much. She's like, I do. No, you don't. Then she talks about how she brought it up to him again. He will not carry the conversation. And he's like, what's the problem? And she's like, this isn't how a relationship works. And he didn't seem to care. If you are crying this much within the first few days of dating somebody and are anxious all the time, and this man is not comforting you and reassuring you, it may not be you. Sometimes it is us. But this, nobody should be crying this much right out of the gate. Especially when his response is like, I hate being forced to like make conversation. Do you see how he's subtly accusing her of being like a control freak and a bully? a nag. Oh God, I'm running out of time. Comment for part two.